the drug war and mass arrest and the militarization that, of police that accompanied the drug war, that has destroyed effectively quality policing and rendered irrelevant in some respects the police department when it our modern police departments in America when it comes to actually what job one should be, which is preventing violent crime or even crime with victims. Instead, we've become an army of occupation. This is something that I've been arguing since I guess The Corner, which would have been published in 98, is that we have to end the drug war. And we have to end the notion that we can continue to use the handcuffs on our own citizens in these numbers and continue to police poor people and people of color to this degree over that which doesn't matter. We have to police people over what truly matters, which is victimization and crimes against people. But the rest of this stuff has just become a war on the poor and a war on the outsiders in our society. And it's been that way for now 30, 40 years. We've been building this one brick at a time.
So that's really interesting for me to sort of clock that you, with all your work and research, are tracing this back to the war on drugs when it first began 30 or 40 odd years ago. But I want to ask you to just to expand on what you said, army of occupation. You talked about in 2015 about Freddie Gray, who was killed in Baltimore. And you said, you know, he's no way unique or remarkable. And then you told the New York Times, police weren't protecting anything. They weren't serving anyone. They were collecting bodies, treating corner folk and citizens alike as an Israeli patrol would treat the West Bank, or as the Afrikaners would have treated Soweto back in the day. They're an army of occupation. You know, that is a pretty stark and highly charged comparison to make there. And I just want to again ask you to pinpoint exactly what you mean and exactly what turned, what were the police like before 30 or 40 years ago?
Well, it's interesting. You know, if you go back to the 1960s, and earlier, certainly, Baltimore was a predominantly white police department. In fact, almost a virtually segregated police department until the early 60s. And it would have been incredibly racist, and it was incredibly racist, and it was a raid against communities of color structurally. What's incredibly ironic about the war on drugs is that that police department in my majority African-American city has been transformed so that more than half of the officers, and certainly most of the street police, are now African-American. And it's an African-American-led department for the most part for the last 20 or 30 years, with some exception. And yet, the brutality has, if anything, been sustained and has gotten worse. Meanwhile, the clearance rates, the arrest rates for things like murder and robbery and rape, the things that plague all citizens and that you would want to have a meaningful police response to, those have collapsed in my city. But take note, when the drug war ratchets up the arrest, when more people go into handcuffs, when we arrest more people for drug crimes, we actually arrest less criminals and we solve less crime. That's not an accident. So this thing has become, it actually goes past the simplicities of American racism, which are profound problems in their own. But it goes past the idea that this is just a binary problem of white police and black communities. This is classism. And the drug war basically allowed American policing to put off reform. And integration allowed them to put off reform for another two, three generations. These police departments have continued to over-police poor communities for that which really doesn't matter and doesn't improve the quality of life for the people living there, and under-police those communities when it comes to solving the right crimes and removing the people who are the repeat violent offenders. There's been a lot of great reporting on this. You know, that's the trick, is that it's not binary. You know, people who want to say we can do without the police, that's problematic too. That's problematic too. We can certainly do without this policing. But there are other things that have to happen in order for the city to become livable and fundamentally equal for everybody who resides there.
Okay, so I want to dig down a little bit more because our previous guest, Baroness Amos, from a different perspective, also linked racism and classism, obviously. And you've just done it as well. And you've brought up the fact that Baltimore is now, I think you said, I think I heard you right, majority black police force. And we've also heard from the mayor of Atlanta in response to the latest, obviously, violence there about the reforms that they instituted there. Can I just play what she said and then we'll dig more into this aspect of it?
We have implicit bias training in this city. We require people to go to the National Center for Civil and Human Rights. We have housing for our police officers in many of our communities in which they are serving in, but yet and still it's not enough.
So what is the answer then? I mean, you've really touched on something that's fundamentally important, that it's not just racism, which plays a huge part, but it's also the other. What is the answer? Where do you see reform, having done so much on the ground reporting of this issue?
I know I sound like a broken record, but we have to end the drug war. We have to end the prohibition against drugs. It has become an overlay for the worst kind of police excesses. It has taught generations of police officers, and it's happened geometrically in some respects because we continue to militarize. And now the sergeants and lieutenants who learned how to do bad police work one generation ago, they're training the new guys coming in how to do bad police work. We have to stop that. We have to get back to policing. Policing is not soldiering. When you declare something a war, you have to have an enemy. And if you have an enemy, you're going to police in a different way than if you're functionally looking at a community as being the real estate that you're supposed to protect. The drug war has destroyed American policing. Now, that is not to say that American policing was clean or pure, or as we've noted already, the racism was inherent prior to the civil rights moment. But what's incredible is how little bump we've gotten out of integrating our police departments. If it was purely about racism, that's been a constant in American life. And if anything, our police agencies have become integrated. And yet, we, the public, the politicians and the public that elects them, we've asked them to do the wrong job. And we've asked them to do the wrong job, the job that basically creates not a policing agency and not something that protects people and responds to real crime, but we've created agencies that are basically targeting communities and are teaching the cops that the metrics for advancement as a police officer, which is, you know, money, overtime, court pay, or rank, that these things are tied to mass arrest and to brutal policies of occupation, rather than quality policing, rather than going out and locking up the right guy for doing the right crime, which is what it's about the only job we need the police for, but it is an essential job.
So I want to ask you then, what sort of person goes into the police force? What sort of qualifications, what sort of pay does a rookie police have? You've just explained how the advancement works on those metrics. But what kind of education and basic training do they get from the get-go?
Well, I'm going to say the education varies. You actually get a bump if you have a college degree in Baltimore. I can only speak to Baltimore. I think Baltimore, the entry right now is about $53,000 a year. It's a civil service job. You know, if you get past your probationary period, you've got all the security of a civil service job in a prioritized agency. There's a lot of critique of the performance of police unions, not merely as collective bargaining agents to secure pay and benefits and bargain collectively on behalf of their membership, but as political entities, lobbying entities that have been arguing for a ratcheting up of police powers and of the policies of mass arrest and mass incarceration. I'm on the board of my writers union, of the film writers union. And we're in the AFL-CIO. We just took a vote, my union, to ask the AFL-CIO membership to remove police unions, which is an extraordinary act for anybody in collective bargaining. But the idea that, you know, I believe in collective bargaining for every employee against labor. I believe in that. But I can no longer abide by the notion that they're going to argue for these policies that are so damaging to so many other working people in their fellow unions.
That's...
Well, the whole structure
is fascinating.
the whole structure of what it takes to be, listen, there are good people who join police departments to do the right thing.
Yeah.
And then they're put in the maw of a structural system that is basically saying, we're putting you out on the street to police a drug prohibition in areas where American industry has completely abandoned the central city, where jobs are scarce, where the drug corner is always hiring, where in every third house in certain blocks, somebody might be drug involved. We're basically asking you to police them as if everybody's the enemy and if everybody's subject to the handcuffs. And once you do that, it doesn't matter where you came from. You're going. It's where you're going. You're going to become part of Pharaoh's army, and that's what we've created.
Okay, I need to ask.
We must end the drug.
Yes, well, exactly.